this is where we're going to be able to get more into district level, school building level, and even classroom level kinds of issues, or at least I hope we do. So I'm going to ask each of the panelists to introduce him or herself and talk about why you think this is an important issue. You can start to talk about what you're doing from your place, but keep it brief and we'll keep the conversation going. Adam.
Good morning.
You got 10 more minutes.
To those of you who are still left, I'm Adam Urbanski. I'm president of the Rochester, New York Teachers Union. And we're in a fortunate situation that we have a very collaborative relationship between labor and management. And essentially, I think that that's the main point. If the relationships are there, then the prospects for attempting and implementing reforms and improvements such as this and many others equally important are there, and it would be a sin of omission not to try. But if the relationships are not there, let me quote Mr. T, I predict pain. It's not going to be easy going. So we're pretty much following our national president's advice, Randy Weingarten, proponent of solution-driven unionism, says, if you can do it with us, not to us, and if it's good for kids and fair to teachers, then let's go for it. We're very fortunate to have the largest concentration of expanded learning time schools, about 15% of our entire student population, and 20% of our secondary schools are involved in.
In Rochester.
And that's largely thanks to the leadership and the passion of our superintendent, from whom you'll hear later, Dr. Bolgen.
Let's do that for kind of continuity here.
Yep. I definitely agree with Adam, and I think that you heard it before that you need principal teachers and everyone at the school level to be involved, to be a participant in a meaningful way. And you had to do this from the beginning. And we are very fortunate with the help that we are getting from the Ford Foundation, also from the Time and Learning Organization. So we don't have the expertise to do it alone. And we also realize that we need a teacher from the let go, as well as principal to be involved. And also, another point that was made here is the community. The finance is not available to us. But we also, although we do have the ultimate responsibility for educating our students, there's no way that we can do it alone.
How many students are in Rochester?
We have 32,000 students.
And Adam just said what percentage are part of this. What's your goal? The question from the earlier panel, or to Secretary Duncan, will it be for all children?
That would be my goal. I do believe that every child, particularly in Rochester, 90% of our students qualify for free and reduced lunch. This is common sense that you need to give our students, particularly students that come from my background. I mean, if you come to school behind, it only makes sense that if you're going to close the achievement gap, you're going to have to give them more time. And I believe that learning is a function of time and effort, and of course, quality teachers and good school as well.
I'm going to let Meg and Pam get in, and then we'll open it up. Meg. Talk about your district, Fall River.
Sure. Good morning. I'm Meg Mayo-Brown, the superintendent of Fall River Public Schools, which is the seventh largest district in Massachusetts, serving 10,000 children. We have three expanded learning time schools and have experienced great success, largely because of the technical assistance provided to us in the planning stages through Mass 2020, as well as support through our policymakers and local officials, as well as community partners, teachers. It really does, you know, to use the cliche, take a village. to redesign schools in a way that makes good sense for kids. So in our three expanded learning time schools, our schools have met their state targets. One of our schools, which I'd be happy to talk more about later, was declared by our Board of Education as chronically underperforming in 2005. It became an expanded learning time school in 2007. When it was first designated as chronically underperforming, parents could not get out of that school fast enough. There was a mass exodus. Today, in 2012, it is my most over-selected, highest performing middle school in Fall River with a waiting list of students to get in.
That's great, congratulations. Pam, the community connection has obviously been teed up for you.
Yes, it has. My name is Pam Martinez. I'm from Denver, Colorado. And I'm co-director of an organization called Padres y Jovenes Unidos, Parents and Youth United. This is independent from the school district. It's both youth and parents organizing for educational equity and justice, immigrant student rights, and college preparation for all students. Denver is a majority minority school district. We're now up to, I believe, 60%, 65% free and reduced lunch. We have entire schools that are grossly undereducating, undergraduating, overdropped out, et cetera, as many people know from the various districts across the country. It's not particular to Denver. We have parents who already had developed a platform for educational change in the Denver public schools that included a longer school day and year before we heard about extended learning time. We were delighted. We were like, oh yes, good. People are taking it up. Where did our parents, most of our parents are low-income parents of color, maybe went to fifth grade, ninth grade, some to 11th. Many are Spanish-speaking parents, immigrant parents, along with African-American, et cetera. Parents who did not even make it out of the regular K through 12 system, and they want their kids to be prepared to go to college. Whether the kids go or not, we say, is up to them. But we want all children prepared to go to college, and we believe that extended learning time through participatory research of the mothers showed that our succeeding schools in low-income communities of color all had an extended learning day and year. They all did. And so they based their platform on best practices. And that was one of the threads running through all the schools they found to be producing for their children.
Adam, let me jump in and let's talk a little bit more about teachers unions and their partnership in these initiatives. What percentage of the Rochester Teachers Association would you say supports this? Practically speaking,
100% of teachers in Rochester support better use of time in schools. They support that in conjunction with other very much needed changes, without which this additional time will be additional wasted time. For example, project-based learning instead of rote learning, performance-based assessments rather than memorization or guessing, lower class sizes, increasing children's readiness for learning. This is why we support it in Rochester, is because it is done, the expanded learning time is done in conjunction with these things. It absolutely would not have any support if it were more of the same. As a matter of fact, you'd need to extend it more than the calendar permits.
How is it dealt with in the contract?
But in the contract, let me give you a contractual example. Good that you asked the question. We're doing something because we know that this can only work well if teachers own it. If they feel that it's being done with them, we actually have a condition that in Rochester, schools can participate only through our school level living contract agreement. So what that essentially means is that at each school, the teachers, through their faculty reps, have the right to negotiate contractual provisions with the principal of the school. And whatever they negotiate must receive 80% approval of the teachers. And when they do that, nobody, including their union, second guesses them. So it's a very high threshold, but it decentralizes collective bargaining so that it's not imposed on the school, but it is accepted, negotiated with the ones. In other words, we want to make sure that there's not a huge difference between those who do the cooking and those who do the eating. So we involve teachers directly so that they own it, they have a stake in it, and we think that that increases the likelihood of success.
So we've got good tweets going on here. Superintendent, what would you say the lessons learned in this relationship with the Teachers Association?
Well, we did put it to test. So we had one school this past summer, and we got 97% of the teacher approved. And I, to be quite honest with you, I know that with they have strong support, but I didn't know it was as strong as it was showing this past summer. So it is extremely important to know that we're just in the beginning. In Rochester, this is the first year that we basically had a situation in Rochester where through the turnaround model, we had a lot of schools that what we call in Rochester and elsewhere, I'm sure, phase in, phase out. I mean, you close school and open a new one. And it was doing a lot of harm for a lot of our students and interns, particularly the school that we're being phased out, because it was a slowly process of closing this school. And we found that a lot of the students were not coming to school. Of course, they were losing their teacher because the student population of that particular school was leaving. And we did utilize the extended learning model. And we have one school right now. We call it Old City High, that is from 7 in the morning to 7 at night. And the students, the attendance has improved, and we believe that the students have a better chance to succeed. And that was, again, something that I was surprised, because that was a significant change, at least on time. We do understand that you just can't change the time.
So do you have differentiated staffing in Rochester?
Correct.
Yeah. And teachers come in and start at different times and...
In that particular school, yes.
Yeah.
We have differentiated staffing. We have differentiated pay. We have flexibility in our approach to virtually every aspect of the relationship. I think without flexibility, it will be tough to also expand learning time in a useful way other than just extend what is.
Pam, you were trying to get in.
Yes. Am I on?
Yeah, okay. I wanted to say in relationship to this question, we believe and advocate for parents and students having at least as much of a voice at this table as the unions, the teachers, and the principals. We really do. Because it's a coming together of the people providing the instruction with the receivers of the instruction. Right? And the parents who depend on the district to educate their children. And yes, it is, it lies with the teachers and the principals. So we've pushed schools, pushed for them to be open to ELT because parents and students want it. And they're the receivers of this education. So I just wanted to add that so that when you're looking at opening this up in your district or expanding it, that we look at teacher and parent involvement and student involvement at the high school level.
Meg, we talked about for Rochester whether it was going to be expanded to all students. How do you feel about this as an initiative that's district-wide?
That's certainly my goal, to have all 16 schools in Fall River have expanded learning time, but that each school is redesigned within its own context by a group, groups of teachers, parents, community members, and the principals. We can't lose sight of the significance of that contextual redesign process that needs to take place at the school level.
So, in asking, you hate to ask it a negative way of the you know, where the pushback or the challenges are, the positive way is what are the lessons learned and how have you mitigated against them? What can you share about the real work of this on the ground?
I think it's, for when we first launched Expanded Learning Time in Fall River, there was pushback from parents. Too long for kids, the homework's too much. But the community has really embraced it, I think largely because we've seen such positive results. And of course, resources always come into play. I'm excited to be a part of Time Collaborative because I think it gives us an opportunity to redesign schools in a way that we can reallocate our resources. In Massachusetts, our ELT schools are dependent upon a state legislative line item, so we wait for that news every year in order to fund the schools. In order for us to sustain this long term and expand across all schools, it's critically important that we figure out a way locally to make this work.
So I asked the first panel about building demand, whether it be from the community and the public at large, political and policy communities. I'd be interested in any of your thoughts from your particular perspectives on how you do that.
We are very fortunate in New York State. I do believe that the State Education Department is a strong supporter, but also they believe and I can speak up for them, but it's my sense that they realize that it needs to be integrated along with all the reform. It can't just be the Common Core, for example, is coming. That's going to require a pretty heavy demand in our students and teachers. Extended learning is a way to respond to that kind of pressure that we are getting. The other thing to consider is that we must have across-the-board support. And in Rochester, we are now building community support, as well as families and students.
How are you doing that?
I have an advisory group, for example, of students. And normally I post questions concerning extended the school day. I have a conversation monthly, open conversation with community members. I am in conversation with the business community as well as the foundation so that they understand. One of the things that I'm going to ask the Ford Foundation is to come to Rochester and help put a forum such as this with the business community, with parents and families and students so that they begin to understand what this is all about. I think that Adam's advice is very wise, and that is that you need to engage the teacher, but we also need to engage the parents, because this is unusual. One of the things that I heard from parents, why do you want my kid with 11 hours a day? You know, and that we have a responsibility to have a pretty good answer about that.
Yeah, Adam, about building demand, and I'm interested in the student. What about how the students feel about this?
Some kids like it and some don't. And that doesn't apply just to students. but inordinately important to involve families, because after all, they are the best judge of what their children need. And working outside the context of parents and families would really not be wise or very effective. That's why we have invited, and we are joined. I'm happy to tell you we're joined here by the parent representative from Rochester, Candace Lucas. Ms. Lucas is here. Could you just identify? She's sitting over there. And she is very much involved in this, and I hope will remain, and through her families and parents. But just to pick up on what Dr. Vargas just mentioned, as far as reaching out to the community, one of the most prominent businesses in Rochester is this very accomplished chain of supermarkets, Wegmans Incorporated. And Wegmans essentially became the principal partner in one of our expanded learning schools and is the main recruiter of volunteers, is the main ambassador for the school. So rather than just providing dollars, they're actually providing a kind of management expertise and a technical support and sending the message that it's everybody's business, not just the school's business.
Pam? Sorry, Mike.
But the question is about how do we do outreach
build
and education?
Demand.
Build
That's
demand.
Right.
Thank you.
Well,
build
just
demand.
I was going to say, outreach is going
one
that
thing.
Way.
Yeah.
Demand is making sure, you know, trying to ensure
Yes. Well, first of all, thanks to the Ford Foundation, seriously, we're able to really grow this work out and do tremendous amount of community education on extended learning time and what it means for advancing whole school reform to our community. So we've been able to link it to all the other demands that just surface, which are, college prep for all students, close the achievement gap, have options for our children that are not based on their zip code, et cetera. So we do massive education on that. The other thing in Denver that I think is unique is we have a new initiative. It's called the Integration Project, and whereby organizations such as ourselves, Padres and Jovenes Unidos, are coming together with the Legacy Foundation, the National Center for Time and Learning, school districts, and a myriad of other partners in this effort to advance extended learning time in the state of Colorado. We, as a grassroots organization, also hold press conferences, right? We put out publications that we present to the school board, we present to the union. We're everywhere, aside from just the work we do with parents, wanting it in their individual schools.
Meg, I'm sorry, I had.
So I also happen to be a parent in the district that I lead, and my children attend expanded learning time schools. So as we talk about both from the parent piece as well as creating a demand among students, when students see that other kids are having fun, right, and they're engaged in school, they want that for their school too. You know, my children have been able to participate in such things as astronomy through an astrophysics partnership with Harvard. They've been in duct tape engineering. They've been in guitar. I mean, it gives kids a reason to attend school, frankly, but they want to go. There's an engagement around learning. So now that we have them at the school, we're able to target intervention as well. So not only is school fun because there's this enrichment component to it, we also have more time to offer very targeted, specific intervention to make sure that we're closing that achievement gap that we've spoken of this morning. And teachers want it too. I hear more and more from my teachers now that are not in ELT schools, I need more time. I need more time with my colleagues, and I need more time with my kids.
So how do you work with your principals or or teachers who need practical information to be able to do this? How do you share information? And
so, you know, we meet with our principals all together, but I think most importantly in this endeavor, it's really been through the technical assistance that's been provided to us through Mass 2020, and now the Time Collaborative around redesigning schools with teams of teachers and administrators, and we'll bring parents and community members to the table.
Professional
again.
Development? I mean, is it in the form of professional development?
It's in the form of professional development. It's in the form of a statewide network. There are many, you know, opportunities to come together and learn from one another in terms of what works, what the effective practice is around expanded learning.
I kind of asked that of Rochester earlier, but how do you make sure that everybody is sharing best practice and lessons learned?
Yeah, like I say, we just began this work. So engaging people with a conversation, first defining what does it mean to have extended learning day in your school. I think we also had the technical expertise of the National Center, Jennifer and others helping us. But I think the way to begin this, we need to demystify what has been happening for the past decade. And there's been a lot of flavor of the month in terms of you do this year, next year you do X. So I'm trying to make sure that we know that we are serious about this, that this is research-based. But most significantly, it's common sense. I mean, when you talk about my students, for example, don't have opportunity for art, music, sport, extracurricular activity. I think some of you have seen the report from Harvard, from Robert Parkman, talking about that today our children have less opportunity to participate in sport that they had 10 years ago.
Yep.
That is the case in Rochester.
Yep.
Our children have less opportunity for art, music, extracurricular activity, and yet also for summer youth employment and summer learning. So again, we need to connect it to the larger work and also contextualize in a particular setting, and that's in 2012. But we cannot forget what have been happening for the past decade around education, particularly in urban districts through the No Child Left Behind, which have forced many districts to introduce change that at times have been rushed, at times have not been well planned. And if there's one thing unique about this initiative is that we do have time to plan, I hope.
Adam?
Well, the union had to change in order to remain a very helpful partner. So the teachers union now is the principal provider of professional development for teachers. We actually spend more money on the professional needs of our members than on all the other needs of our members and more attention. And we do that in collaboration with the district. Very often our superintendent and other experts from the school system are the featured presenters at professional development sponsored by the union. But the way in which we ensured that teachers would feel like they have to get involved is through decentralizing collective bargaining and allowing certain provisions to be negotiated at the school, including this one, how to utilize time. And that, in a way, guarantees that teachers would not remain bystanders, that they would be motivated to learn how others are doing, and that they would network with others and learn how to do it. So I think that the best way to build these kinds of relationships and to build involvement and ownership is to actually give an active role and a meaningful decision-making role to the people who will have to implement it.
I'm going to open it up for questions in just a couple minutes. Pam and Meg, this issue of teachers, principals, others, even community members saying, yet here's the latest thing. Here's the latest program to come down the pike. How do you work against that kind of thinking?
We really base what we organize for, what we work for, on best practices. We no longer will take up anything that has not been proven in practice. That's number one. But what I also wanted to add, once community feels they're a viable stakeholder in something, that it's for their kids, the mothers are unstoppable. They really are. Like, we have this conflict in Denver implementing ELT, extended learning time, with not having appropriate transportation. Because kids are getting out later. Some kids have to get home a little bit earlier to pick up brothers and sisters. There's real things in the community around making this change. So now the mothers are organizing for transportation with the director of transportation. Have held two community meetings and are building what is called the Success Express, which will come every 15 minutes to a whole series of schools. We'll save the district money, yes. They're happy, and the mothers are going to ride those buses and make sure it's working. That's how you overcome the obstacles and give ownership back to the community and the students.
May.
There's such strong support for this right now in Fall River, again, based on the success of the three schools. So we're gonna leverage that support and try and include as many schools as we can in the initiative right now.
I would
now.
Think it could even be the opposite, that the people who don't have these opportunities are clamoring or mad or critical, right?
It's sort of developing
managing
to,
expectations,
an
right?
equity issue in the district. You know, some schools have more time, others don't. The parents want to see all children have that kind of opportunity.
Okay, we're going to take three quick questions back here. I have to be careful not to, sorry about my back.
Hi, I'm Jen Reinhart with the After School Alliance. And it's really exciting, of course, the work that Ford is doing to bring more attention to the need for expanded learning for kids. The report shows that schools on average are extending the day by about 75 minutes, and very few of them are going into the summer. And Secretary Duncan talked about the importance of the hours between 3 and 6 p.m. and the need for these kind of critical learning opportunities for kids during that whole time span and keeping kids safe. So I'd like to hear a little bit about, as local leaders, what's happening in your districts to help ensure that kids have access to expanded learning opportunities that go beyond the school day and into the summer
And into the summer as well. A question? Oh, come on. This is right here.
Yes, I was wondering about, my name is Kelly Young, and I'm with an organization called Convergence, but my question comes from being a parent and also working with our principal currently of a public school here in D.C. planning time is immensely short. And so I understand that extended time, we will get more time for planning, but how this whole year that you have to dedicate to planning, that it has you integrate all of these reforms, because in the district right now, we're adopting the Common Core, a new curriculum, all of the testing, trying to think of how to integrate technology, all of these things, and there seems to be about this much time to actually have teachers, principals, parents actually meet at the same time. So I'm wondering how you get this over this hurdle before you implement it.
I like both of these in practically speaking. How does it work out? One more question. All right, let's tackle these two. Practically speaking, how do we build in to extend time 3 to 6, 3 to 7, as well as summer? First question.
I think you have to engage the community-based organization for sure, because in terms of resources, that's crucial and critical.
And what does that look like?
What does look like is, for example, we have the YMCA down in Rochester. They might run swimming pool classes for my kid between 5 and 6. We also have an organization that provides meal. That's interesting in child nutrition. We do have right now 2 schools that are giving dinner to students and a kid that wants it. So you might be, a child might be doing the homework between 3 and 4, because part of the challenges here about this opportunity gap is that our students have less opportunity to go home to a household that they are going to get the support for homework. So I do believe that the school has the capacity and the community to mitigate that. So it's coming together to the same table and see what children need. Or I like to always say, let's begin with one question. What do we want to do for kids?
Is there something like a children's cabinet in Rochester?
We don't have such a thing, but we do have a strong group at the school provider that have been led by the United Way and other organizations.
We actually do have, for many years now, almost 2.5 decades, student representatives, elected student representatives on the school-based management team of every middle school and high school. So there is so in addition to what Dr. Vargas mentioned, I just want to briefly comment on a question about the planning time. I was really happy that the way that this expanded learning time is being framed is not just as more time for kids and no more for the adults, because if truth be told, American teachers already spend more time in direct contact with students than the teachers in virtually all industrialized nations. So more bad time in front of the kids is not the answer. So if teachers, but the difference is that in most successful nations, education successful nations, teachers have substantially more time to plan, to conference about students, to hold office hours, to do all kinds of work preparing for more useful time in direct contact with students. So we are putting a premium on that in Rochester, that yes, some kids need more time. Most kids in our district need more time. Not all kids, but most do. But all of our teachers need more time to be more thoughtful about the practice and to prepare better and to learn from each other.
Meg, how about in Fall River?
Yes, certainly I agree, and I think that's one of the great benefits that we've had through expanded learning time, because it's not just about more time for kids. It must be about more time for teachers to collaborate. So our teachers have set in a given week have 7 individual prep periods to their own, and then 3 common planning times where they're working together as well. All of that geared toward, specifically targeting individual student needs, engaging the school in school improvement planning, and also designing these enrichment and intervention standards-based units.
And there's a union in Fall River?
There is a union in Fall River.
And what is the dynamic, and how much of this is contractual?
All of it. The majority of it is contractual, certainly. When we became an expanded learning time district, we needed to negotiate with the union around provisions that are now placed firmly in the contract.
So now that's a good thing, because they're in the contract.
That is.
Pam?
I just wanted to share from a practical, very practical parent perspective. We've sent parents a year ago to see Generation Schools in Brooklyn, New York, because we wanted to see a successful example of extended learning time in a really low income, like our communities, right? And then they showed us how they use different scheduling and earlier spoken to staggering of teachers, both on vacations, on school day, on hours, and have done it at a minimal transition cost, and then it breaks even. And now we're partnering with Gen Schools, who is now in Denver. We have chapters there and people working there, youth and parents, to better understand the inner workings of how this all fits together, plus to help build this school.
So I'm going, I pride myself on meeting my deadlines. And so we're going to do the lightning round down the row. Your best practical advice for working within the context of a district, a local community, to pursue this work.
Get everyone involved that need to be part of this effort.
I'd say the same thing. Get everybody involved, and in particular, get parents and get students involved. Not just the students always elected to positions. Open it up to those students who are being pushed out or have left and want to make change and come back.
Meg, I would echo, honor the voices of those that are part of the community and part of the school.
Do you have a local education fund or a parent advocacy kind of group? And
no, we don't.
I meant every word they said. and I would add this, contextualize it in conjunction with some other important things that have to be done. For example, teacher preparation. The AFT just released, the American Federation just released Raising the Bar, a terrific report about the importance on how to really improve student learning by improving the teaching profession, which, by the way, is exactly how the medical profession became modern through the Flexner report on the preparation of physicians. So I would say do it not as a silo, but in conjunction with an emphasis on active project-based learning, performance-based assessments, real teacher preparation, lower class size, et cetera.
With Adam's benediction, I would like to ask you to thank our panel. Jennifer?
Jeannie, thank you so much for your thoughtful presentation. Thank you, panelists, for being here today and for all the work you're doing on the ground, both groups of panels. All those of you who are here in the room, we look forward to working with you over the next 5 years to embark on this journey. Thank you to the Ford Foundation, Jeannie and her team, for the fabulous partnership and leadership. We are going to be tracking and documenting and sharing lessons learned in our effort to spread this nationally across the country. So stay tuned for the next phase of this work, and I want to turn it over to my wonderful partner, Jeannie Oakes.
Hi, thank you, Jennifer. I am Jeannie Oakes. I direct the education programs at the Ford Foundation, and I couldn't be prouder than I am today. This is a signature moment, I think, for the Ford Foundation in bringing together and enabling this amazing group of federal, state, and local leaders to not only express the passion and commitment they feel for young people in their education, but to help them find a way to make it real, to make it concrete in the form of this collaborative. So I have two words for you that you should take away with you, and it's the mantra at the Ford Foundation, and the words are both more and better. And we never separate both of them. When we're talking about more time for young people, more time for teachers, more time and opportunities for young people to be safe between the hours of 3 and 6, more engagement of community partners, the integration of the whole community, wrapping their arms and their resources around these young people, it's always about better as well, more and better. So thank you all. We have your names, we have your emails, and we look forward to engaging you in all of this work as we go forward.